Okay, good evening, everyone. I think we'll get going. It's about 10 after, and I want to make sure to get started on time or close to it so we can be done at about 9 o'clock and go home and enjoy the rest of the evening. My name is Mike Welty. I am a senior land use planner with Barton and Judas. We are working with the town on this study of Route 299 Exit 18 Gateway. And so I'm going to kind of lead us through the meeting tonight. And I have a pretty simple agenda that I'd like to go through with you first. What we want to start with is a little presentation. All right, so I'm going to give you a little background about the project, what it is that we're looking at, why we're looking at it, and so forth. We'll talk a little bit about existing conditions in this area, in the study area. So, you know, talk about the land use, the zoning, the infrastructure, and so forth. And then I'll wrap that part of the presentation up with some discussion about opportunities as I see them. All right, some things to think about, food for thought, as it relates to this area. Hopefully, you know, we'll be done with that portion of the evening in about a half hour, 40 minutes. Then we're going to break out into four groups. At tables around the room, four still seems like a good number, maybe three. We'll see how if anyone trickles in. But we're going to have you work with us. There's different people from my office here, Rebecca, Katie, and Ted. We're going to work at one of us at each of the tables to get your thoughts, because we're really at the very beginning of this process. And so we're not presenting an outcome to you tonight. We're trying to get your ideas tonight. We'll be back at the end of the summer, the beginning of the fall, to present some ideas, and you can tell us how we're doing at that point. But tonight, it's going to be helping us come up with those ideas. We'll come back together so everyone can kind of hear what the other groups thought, and then we'll wrap up, and we'll try to be done at 9 o'clock. Okay, does that sound good? All right. Excellent. So, let's start with the presentation. Oh, thank you for that. Can everyone see the screen okay? I'll try to move around a little. I realize that no matter what I do, I'm going to be blocking somebody. I apologize for that. One thing we do have to get is one of those remote controls. That would really be fancy. Yeah. So anyway, the project basically that we're working on is a project that was initiated by the town board in February. The town board appointed a committee, the Route 299 Gateway Committee, with the following purpose, and this comes right out of the resolution that created the committee. It's to solicit input from the community with workshops, interviews, and hearings to review the town comprehensive plan as it relates to the Route 299 Gateway area, which I will describe some more in a moment, and to revise the plan and the town's zoning code as needed to reflect the community's vision for this important entranceway to the town and the village. All right? So, there's a couple important points there that I just want to maybe spend a minute on explaining, because all these words may not be something that, you know, everyone is as familiar with. So first of all, we're starting with the comprehensive plan. And the comprehensive plan in New Paltz is actually a document that's over 20 years old. It was last adopted in 1995. Not surprisingly, it does reflect a little bit the fact that it's not that current. But what a comprehensive plan basically is a policy document, right? It's a community's opportunity to take a look at its current conditions, evaluate how things are going, to envision the future 5 or 10, 15 years out, think about where the community wants to be. And then ultimately, the plan is about how you get from here to there, right? And so that's the simplest way to describe a comprehensive plan. And so the town has a comprehensive plan, again, dating back to 1995, that does those things. It has a series of goals, you know, visions, goals, some recommendations for achieving those goals. Many of those things were probably accomplished, others maybe not. But in either case, you know, it's been a while since it's been really looked at in a comprehensive way. So if we're going to make changes to land use regulations, we want to start with the plan, all right? Because the land use regulations, zoning, which is what a term I'm sure most of you are familiar with, zoning is really a mechanism for implementing the plan. right? Because most of the development activity that goes on in our communities is done by private individuals, landowners, developers, whatever, who own property, who are going to, who propose to make some change on that property. And the framework for that change is found in your regulations, in your zoning regulations. So they should be updated from time to time, just as your plan is updated from time to time. And under state law, your zoning, our subdivision regulations, or any other land use regulations must be in accordance with your comprehensive plan. Right? So when we look at our zoning for this particular area of town, we need to start by looking at what the plan says for this particular area of town. See if that fits, if it's something that we might want to refine or change in some manner, and then have our land use regulations brought up to match what we say we want to achieve in the plan. Okay? So that's sort of the reason why both of those things are mentioned in the resolution. We have a committee of residents from the town who most of them are here tonight. If you want to raise your hand quick if you're on the committee, right? So we've got a number of people sitting in the back. The committee has been meeting now approximately once a month since March. Get organized, start looking at some of the existing conditions, talk about where this study might go, and getting ready for this opportunity tonight to start to engage all of you in the community about the process. We do also have a website, a web page on the town's website that's now been established, and you can get information about the study as we go forward on that web page. We've been, for example, putting the meeting notes up there after we've had a chance to look at them and say that they're ready. So you'll find the meeting notes from March 20th and April 17th there currently. All right. In terms of a schedule, some of you may have heard of this moratorium, right? Some of you are maybe even here because of the moratorium. That is, the moratorium is basically something that the town board adopted earlier this spring. Recently went into effect. The town board had decided that it wanted to put a temporary halt to things going on, in terms of approvals anyway, not so much the review, the review can still go on, but the approvals until it's had a chance to complete this process. And so that's going on. We got started a little before that, thankfully, and anticipate trying to wrap up our process by the end of the year, before the moratorium expires, and so that we'll be ready, the town will be ready at that point. So as I mentioned, we're right here, this is our first public workshop where the circle is, and this is initial, this is our first look, listening to you tonight. We'll be back in September with some initial recommendations. That'll be the next time that we have a public meeting like this. And again, we're shooting to wrap this up for the end of the year. So let's look a little bit at the area that we're studying. This is an aerial photo of the village and the town, part of the town, not all of the town. You can see, the thruway, the exit 18 interchange here, the village, the wall hill, the farmland over on the west side. And really, the area that we're looking at focuses on Route 299, and the area around the interchange, and we'll talk some more about exactly how that, what that looks like. Here's just a little bit of a zoom in, all right? So some of the features that really stand out, again, obviously the thruway here, the village, the town going into the village on 299, 299 going out towards Poughkeepsie over here. Here's South Ohioville, North Ohioville, the hamlet is here, Ohioville. Right here is North Putt, South Putt. Okay, so everyone kind of has a sense of where we're at. And this term, gateway, what does that mean? Why, what are we saying when we say gateway? Really, it's just a way of acknowledging that this is an important entrance way to the community, right? Lots of people who come to New Paltz enter the community through this particular area, right? Either they're coming from the north or south on the thruway, or they're coming from the east over in Poughkeepsie into New Paltz this way. Maybe they're coming to New Paltz, maybe they're heading to other points further west, north, south, from there. But it is an important entranceway to the community. It's one of the first things people see when they arrive. New Paltz is a destination. A lot of people find this a very attractive community to be. Obviously, you find it an attractive community to be in and you live here. Others find it a nice place to work, come to school, visit, so forth, right? And so that's the notion of gateway. But really, the study area here is an area that is basically a commercial district, commercial zone district, that's been in place for many years, many decades, that runs really the entire length of 299 from pretty much the village line out to almost the town of Lloyd. The study area is primarily focused on, again, this commercial district, this B2 business district. There is a piece of this, since this is in common ownership, of this industrial piece down here that is included in the study area. But, you know, it's basically, this goes back to, you know, again, predates the last comprehensive plan, this notion of just having commercial zoning all along the state highway from kind of end to end, right? So that's been in place for quite a long time. And we'll talk about that and you know, how people are view that kind of a zoning today in just a moment. In terms of land use, now this is a little, you know, if you've been looking at the maps at all when you came in, just realize land use in this instance is being generated from tax property death, right? So it's whatever the assessor codes the property as for the purposes of collecting tax. So sometimes people will look at it very carefully and say, you know, I don't think that's vacant, I think it's something else, or I think that's agricultural, not, you know, it's still useful to us to give us a sense for what we're looking at. There is obviously, although it is a commercial district, or most of it is, there is some residential area. There's, of course, the reds are commercial, the grays are vacant. So it's kind of a mix of commercial and vacant land with a little bit of residential in the actual study area. Of course, surrounding it, you have a host of other types of land use as well. One of the real significant features of this whole study area is that it is really laced with environmental resources, right? Very significant, primarily wetlands, as you know, east of the thruway, along 299, that's really one of the predominant features of this area. And so, you know, they're either regulated by the state, by the federal government, and actually here in New Paltz also by the town. The town has its own water, wetland and water course law, which it enforces. So this is actually a portion of the town's wetland and water course map. So again, here's 299, here's the exit, here's the freeway, and so all of these areas are protected wetlands, and the buffers that surround them. So, you know, much of the area then is not really developable. It's limited pretty significantly in that regard. It's just not that all the land should be developable, but that's just stating some facts. The state of infrastructure out here is a bit of a mix as well. You've got some water districts in the town that are, you know, the water itself actually comes from the village, but they are primarily on the west side of the thruway, right, with the very exception of the 87 Motel and actually the thruway buildings themselves. There's a small water district there. In terms of sewer, again, town districts located primarily adjacent to the village. With one exception, there is a town sewer district out in Ohioville. It is quite limited, though, in terms of its capacity. It's not something that can be readily expanded in terms of its capacity, primarily because it doesn't have a good place to empty into. It's not a big growth inducer there, but that's where the infrastructure is. So, kind of putting them together in a composite, the areas that are in purple have both sewer and water. Those are areas, again, primarily along Main Street or 299 as you go in toward the village. And then as you get away from that, you've got some areas that just have water or just have sewer. Transportation. As many of you, I'm sure, are aware, this is a pretty busy part. The entrance into New Paltz on a lovely fall afternoon, weekend afternoon is tricky for people visiting and for you all to get around. It certainly should feel the same way. There are groups that have looked at this corridor quite carefully over the last number of years. The town and village have a transportation implementation committee that continuously looks at these issues. They work closely with the Ulster County Transportation Council, which is the MPO, or Metropolitan Planning Organization for Ulster County. The MPO did a sort of comprehensive study of transportation and land use back in 2006, so it's a little more than 10 years old now. That study included a whole host of different ideas, alternatives for improvements in the corridor. All of them had trade-offs, and I'm sure many of them have their own pros and cons that people have weighed in on over the years. I did recently meet with the MPO just to see where we're at in terms of anything new that's coming in the corridor. The only real new project that's coming starting later this year will be along South Putt Corners Road. Some improvements to the shoulders, some turn lanes and things like that, basically from Route 32 up to 299. So I guess there's just getting into that now, and we'll be towards the end of the year actually seeing some activity out there. The other big one, but it's not in the town, but it'll be interesting and it's, I think, important to think about for this corridor, is actually over in the town of Lloyd, which is the trail. The Hudson Valley Rail Trail, Phase 4, is actually going to start construction sometime this fall as well, and that'll bring the trail, which originates at the walkway, all the way to South Street. So we're getting really on the doorstep at this point of the town. And that will lead me to this notion of connecting the trails, right? There's basically now just that little gap. It's not that little, but it's getting smaller all the time between the Walkill Valley Rail Trail and the Hudson Valley Rail Trail. And that, of course, will run right through the corridor. So in case, I know you can't see that all that well, so I added a little animations. There's the Walkill Valley Rail Trail, right? Way over there on the right side is the Hudson Valley Rail Trail. So basically, the 299 corridor will be the conduit for this connector. Exactly where the connector will go is not clear. There's been some work done to study alternatives, and so we have some ideas. But essentially, it's going to take us through the corridor to Putt, and then it'll head north and then west on Du Bois. That part will be for the bikes. Pedestrians will probably at that point be sent down Main Street, so they can take advantage of all the fun things to do there, and then ultimately get used to the Walkill Valley Rail Trail. But that'll be a pretty significant link for two very busy and very important regional systems that draw a lot of people to this area. So as I mentioned, there's been some analysis of different alternatives for that connector, but a final determination of where exactly the trail will go remains to be seen. This is something that will happen. It's just kind of a question of when, right? So it is currently on the transportation improvement program in the region, but it's not set to come into effect for a few years yet. So I believe it's something like maybe 2019 for design, and then getting on into the early 2020s for construction. However, just this spring, the state made, there was a big announcement under the governor for this Empire State Trail, which is investing a couple $100 million statewide in a trail system that will be known as the Empire State Trail. This corridor, this link, we anticipate will be part of that. And so some portion of that money will hopefully come to this section of trail. But what exactly that means, what kind of incremental improvements they might be able to make under the Empire State Trail, and then things that might have to come later. That, again, remains to be seen. We will know a little bit more about the Empire State Trail, though, as we get into the fall, because it seems to be on a very it's on a big push. So they're trying to get information together and out as quickly as possible. So hopefully we'll know more. The comprehensive plan. I alluded to the fact that it's a few years old, 1995. It does have it does provide, I think, some broad policy direction for something like this corridor. But it's not like real crisp, in terms of what it all means. But some of the goals that I think are worth noting as they relate to the corridor would be things like protecting environmentally sensitive areas. So we said before, there's a lot of natural resources in this corridor. And of course, it's a scenic road and vista in terms of the entry into New Paltz. Establish environmentally sound land use policies to ensure a balanced and orderly pattern of future growth and economic stability. So it recognizes that we both want to manage and take care of those natural resources well, but we also want to grow in an orderly way and want to support the both the tax base and the economy. This is a commercial district, as I said, primarily, and so that's still, I would say, relevant. We want to encourage higher density development to locate in areas served by public water and sewer facilities. So as I showed you before, there is some public sewer and water in Carter. Primarily, that infrastructure exists on the west side of the thruway, between thruway and the village. There is that sewer district out in Ohioville, which primarily just serves existing homes there. And seek to provide better traffic conditions and adequate parking in the center of the community. Traffic, obviously you can't ignore the fact that that's an issue here. Traffic includes, in this case, could include a broader definition of transportation, maybe, like the bike trail that we hope will be coming sooner rather than later. In terms of zoning, right, so the zoning in some ways reflects this very broad level policy. And in other ways, I'm not so sure. But it's primarily we're looking at B2 zoning, highway business zoning. There's a long list of commercial uses that are allowed in this zone, right? So everything from restaurants and movie theaters, retail, shopping centers, all those different things. Most of them require site plan review by the planning board. There are very few things that are permitted as of right, right? So somebody's got to sign off on them. There's really no residential allowed in the district, with a caveat that there is a footnote in the area table that suggests that for parcels of a certain size, you can go to the multifamily, it's got a different name, district, the RV district, variable residential density district, and use those provisions. In actuality, there is an opportunity to do multifamily housing under limited conditions in the B2. And the area and bulk standards, things like the setbacks and everything else, are really pretty much standard 1960s, 70s fare, right? It's suburban setbacks. Even as you get in closer to the village, it's really no different from the village line out to Lloyd. Buildings have to be set back pretty far from the street. Most of your parking will be met probably in that area between the building and the street, although it doesn't have to be, but it probably would. Very limited guidance in terms of, what do we want it to look or feel like or function like? Kind of open to your standard kind of commercial stuff, right? So that's the zoning. Things have changed a little bit since 1995, and I just want to talk about some of the ways things have changed and some of the things that communities are thinking about today that might be what we want to, start thinking about here. A couple big ideas in terms of planning over the last decade. Primarily was this notion of smart growth, right? So identifying, areas of the community where you want to focus development, again, like around that infrastructure and so forth, thinking about how to balance that with maybe conservation, thinking about housing options, transportation choices, mixing uses in the center like you have in the village here. Encouraging reuse of existing sites, whether they be old shopping centers or brownfields or things like that. And focusing on revitalizing the existing communities and conserving resources. Recently we start to use the term sustainability, right? And what does a sustainable community look like? The notion that the community, it wants to be a place where you're not borrowing from the future to take your needs for today. If you're thinking about, the economic component, the environmental component, the social component of the community together in a holistic way. That's really a way to think about it. And this does not mean then that economic development and environmental protection are opposed. They are actually, they work together, right? Under this sort of a framework, you think about them as two sides of the same coin. A lot of communities have been thinking a lot more about stormwater. In fact, New York State has made it quite clear that that's what communities need to be thinking about. So how do we stop just funneling our stormwater into a pipe and getting it out and getting it back instead into to recharge the aquifers? So you start to see a lot of green infrastructure, green design being considered as part of projects. These are some examples of bioretention in commercial kind of a setting, parking lot setting, or along the roadway. We are seeing a lot more emphasis on multimodal transportation. So yes, obviously lots of people are getting around by car, but a surprisingly high number of folks don't, and especially actually in New Paltz in the village. The numbers are pretty high for people who don't drive. But thinking about how do we accommodate all of the modes, right? So whether there's public transportation, walking and bicycling, making sure that places are handicapped accessible, all of those things. Sometimes we talk about this in terms of active transportation, right? So the non-motorized would be active transportation. Communities are doing entire plans around that whole concept in parts of New York State. And the economy, of course, has changed quite a lot in the last 20 years. More recently, and this is something that goes on all the time at a macro level, we've seen in the post-recession years a shift in residential living preferences. Whether that's actually preferences or require, what people can actually afford to do is a little unclear. But definitely more interest in renting than there was before. Both in the younger generations, and then as the boomers are aging, maybe also getting out of their single-family homes in some cases. More recently, the retail sector. We're seeing some real dislocation in the retail sector. And this is, again, at the national level that I'm talking about. But whether that's a result of e-commerce, right, internet commerce, or whether it's, because we overbuilt our commercial base over the last, 10 or 15 years, it's probably some combination of those things, right? But clearly there's a shift going on, and it seems to be pretty prominent right now. Where it goes, we really don't know. So when I think of the gateway, I think it's not really about are you pro-development or are you anti-development. It's really what kind of development do we want to see here? In fact, New York State and our economic development folks here in the Hudson Valley and the Mid-Hudson region use this framework of live, work, and play in their economic development plan. Right? There's a recognition even in the economic development circles, that for the region to be successful, we have to have great communities to live in, to work in, and to play in, right? All of those things. So quality of life, economy, social, all of those things. And so, again, back to that notion of sustainability or smart growth, economics, environment, social, all working together, the place in the middle is sort of the target, if you will, right? And so I think we can do a lot by thinking about the form of development rather than yes or no on development. And so I think design is one of those things that is increasingly important in how communities are addressing their development questions. All right, so you're seeing a lot of communities incorporating things like design guidelines or standards into their zoning. You're seeing communities go to entirely form-based codes, which really emphasize almost exclusively like location of buildings and parking and so on, and are much more wide open in terms of use. But design is important, right? Because in this case, each of these places is doing the same exact thing, right? They're making burgers and shakes and fries. And you know, some of you like that, some of you don't. I won't admit to my wife that I do occasionally sneak out and have one of those, especially when I'm on the road for work. But you know, it's not what's going on inside and necessarily, but a lot of it might be how it, the building itself addresses the community. And that's not going to be the same everywhere. But you know, here in, this is an example from Illinois, this is out on Long Island, this is up in, I believe, Stowe, right? These are all buildings that were built in the context of where they are. All, of course, do have their corporate identity intact, but it's been tempered a little bit, right? So this is sort of the, you know, the go-to standard, you know, the corporate, that's what they want. But they are willing and will think about changing if they need to. So, you know, and that's not just McDonald's, that's here's Dunkin' Donuts, same thing, right? Kind of the standard fare, something more in context to the location. You know this, right? I mean, you've seen this here. So it's not entirely outside of our experience either. You know, the Hampton Inn is a chain, it's a hotel. It's in the study area. The developer, it's my understanding, I wasn't here, but I'm told, was very willing to work with the community, with the planning board over time to develop something that people felt pretty content with, pretty happy about. So they, you know, took some architectural detailing that was probably outside of their standard ingredients. You know, the design is a little bit more welcoming for the pedestrian. You can pick apart little things, certainly, but it's, you know, it's pretty nice. Also, County Savings Bank, not surprisingly, a local bank, right? But they also built a building that, in terms of its architecture, feels a little bit more like New Paltz. In terms of its site design, yes, it still has the little bit of parking in the front, but it's pretty well connected to the sidewalk. They made the attempt to bring a nicely detailed crossing to the building. So the monument sign is really quite nice, right? So some attempt was made here as well to do something in fitting with the community. You know, there's all kinds of drugstores, supermarkets, you know, and the context is going to be different where you are. I mean, this is the Adirondacks, right? So it's got that great camp sort of motif going. You know, this is out near Warwick. It's more agricultural in its kind of style. So it's these are fitting with wherever they are located. These things don't typically happen by accident. They do on occasion. Like I said, you will occasionally have a local developer or someone who's going to work with the community. Usually I say local because they're more invested in the community and want to do that. You know, it doesn't have to be, but that's typically the way it is. But you know, most of the time, somebody has to ask for this. Okay, most of the time somebody has to ask for this. And so how do you ask for that? How does the community get this type of an outcome? Well, most commonly, again, is they do it through their land use regulations. Okay, they're gonna make sure that the area and bulk standards and their zoning, the design guidelines, the things that they create for the community help guide what it is that they're looking for in the first place. And so, you know, these are some examples of some documents that are actually local that you can use as a starting point. This is something that was done for the Shawangunk Mountain region. You know, talks, for example, about the orientation of parking lots, you know, trying to keep parking more off to the side, trying to buffer the lots with some natural vegetation, things like that. There's a whole host of different things that this talks about. You can have access management is very important. If you think about 299, right? One of the big things about 299 in our corridor is that you can't really do a lot of, you can't have a lot of driveways on 299. And in fact, DOT has pretty much said, no, you're going to be going out to signalized intersections, and that's it. But, you know, so there you've got, you know, it kind of forces your hand a little bit. But even so, you know, you can do things to make sure that that curb cuts are consolidated, that you have shared access between multiple parcels, so that people don't have to get back out on the street for every, to go from one place to the next. They can actually, you know, so your guidelines can accomplish lots of different things. You can make sure that you have a good pedestrian connection. If you do have to have a parking in the front, how do you make sure that if somebody does walk there, they can get safely to the building without having to walk through all of the parking lot? So you can actually emphasize these kinds of things, or really nice landscaping in your design guidelines. You can get into some of the details like green infrastructure and stormwater management, making sure that different types of permeable pavements, bioretention, things like that take place, or that you have bike racks, or that you have certain kinds of lighting. It's all kinds of things that you can include and guide in these things that will help create the kind of development that you're looking for. The key, I think, and I've tested this with a number of developers that I've had the opportunity to work with over the years, is that they want some fairness, they want some predictability, right? The worst case scenario, and I hate to say it, but it's kind of one of the things that you have currently, is that you have a project that comes in that sits for 3, 4, and more years in review. And it's not really clear what it is that the community is looking for. And they are going to spend all kinds of money trying to figure out if they have the ability to do so. Maybe they're going to wait you out and hope that they can just wait you out. But fairness and predictability are really important to most developers, especially the good ones. And they want to know up front, what is it that the community is looking for? And so to the degree that you can be clear about what it is you're looking for, the better and more, I would say, economically proactive you will be. And so illustrated design guidelines, standards or guidelines are really important, I think, and in my mind are a really big part of what we need to be thinking about here in the Gatebook. Right? So we can be a little bit clearer the next time when somebody's out looking to develop one of these pieces of property in a commercial district. We want to make sure that we're saying what it is we're looking for. Right? So that's the presentation. Hopefully it gives a little bit of food for thought. But let me explain what we're going to do for the remainder, most of our time, for like the next 45 to 50 minutes, all right? Is we're going to split up into four groups. We have four tables, 1, 2, 3, 4, all right? I'm going to come around and assign you a number real quick, and you'll go to that table number. All right, and in the groups, you're going to basically be working with one of us from B&L, and working on answering two questions. All right, so it's sometimes hard to separate these things out, but we're going to try anyway. All right, so first, I want you to start like up here, big picture. Because one of the things I've been struggling with when I look at this 299 exit 18 area in this corridor is this whole notion of, is it really, I mean, it's all B2 zoning, right? So, if I look at this area, it's all B2 zoning, all the way from the edge of the village, all the way out 299 to the town board, right, pretty much. But is it all really the same? All right? Or are there different kinds of characteristics or character that you think might fit in one or another part of the corridor, all right? So think a little bit about that. Let's start kind of big picture, all right, and focus on just that question. Then, once you've done that for 10 minutes or so, and everyone in your group has had an opportunity to sort of weigh in a little bit on that, and there's no right or wrong answer, so it's not something that you have to argue about. We're just trying to get those ideas, capture those ideas in our groups. Let's talk about some of the details. If it is all the same, fine, that's cool. What are some of the details? What should it look like? Should the buildings be up on the road, like in the heart of the village? Should they be set back a little bit from the roadway? Should the parking be out in front of the building? Should it maybe be a little bit in front of the building, most of it on the side and the rear? What kinds of, the zoning allows up to 3 stories. 3-story buildings, is that what you want? Does that make sense? Any of those kinds of things are fair game. So we'll talk about some of the details. If you thought that maybe the corridor is actually not one thing, but 2 things or 3 different things, well, what do the details maybe look like in each of those things, right? Is it different when you're in close to the village than when you're out near the town of Lloyd. Talk to us. Tell us what you think. You know, if we have the road or the trail, if you're on a bike or you're walking, how do you get to the building? All right? Help us think about that. So we're going to, again, I'm going to leave these up. I'm going to quickly come around now, give you a 1 through 4. If you're a 1, you're going to stay right up over here. You're a 2, over here. 3 over there. And a 4 in the back where you signed in. All right? So I'm not going to hit folks on the committee because they're going to kind of wander around and be our eyes and ears just to help us out a little bit. Plus, they get to weigh in all the time. So I'm just going to 1, 2, 3, 4. 1. That's okay. I'll just give you 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. All right, we're going to come over here. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1. No? No, not perfect. All right. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1. All right, try to come back and just sit down for a few more minutes and hear one another, but we're going to do this quick. I just think it's useful to get a sense of what each of the groups talked about. We're not going to go on for a long, long period of time. I'm going to have each of us two minutes or so talking about some of the big ideas that you heard. It'd be interesting to see what other ideas other groups came up with, and then we'll wrap it up. Okay, we'll be done, like I said, by 9 o'clock. I think it's to head home. So I'll start. My group was great. First of all, let me just say, a really nice group of people. A lot of discussion about, you know, what first looking at the study area and what used to be where and all that, which was kind of interesting. Historical perspective. We started to focus on, you know, the big picture question. And everyone kind of felt like, well, you know, as you go west of the thruway towards the village, right now it feels just kind of like a commercial strip, kind of like any place, right? And then as you go east of the thruway, generally we're talking about it feels more rural. But then, you know, we started to think about that a little bit more in more detail. And actually, you know, a couple different concepts sort of emerged. One was like this notion that there's maybe 4 areas, that really west of Putt is 1, right? And then sort of Putt and the interchange and that little no man's land is kind of a second one. Then there's like Ohioville, the hamlet, which kind of still feels like a hamlet, you know, and it has its own character. And then there's sort of the rest of it, which is more rural. And that was kind of an interesting concept. Before we got into that a little bit more, we also noted that this idea that, you know, the thruway is a huge piece of infrastructure. A lot of cars obviously going up and down the thruway. You know, maybe there should be some buffering of the thruway too, that you know, what's alongside the thruway impacts quality of life of people who live, you know, even a quarter mile, half a mile away. So, you know, that was another kind of a way of thinking about that stretch, that north-south line. But anyway, everyone agreed the bike connection is really a great opportunity for New Paltz. Exit 18 is, you know, and that stretch from exit 18 to Putt is viewed as sort of the critical piece, right? Because everywhere else you can kind of see and figure out where a trail would go and how the connection can be made. That spot just feels pretty daunting. And so, you know, attention to that spot, that area is going to be really important. So, we got back to the 4 areas, and we said, you know, that area from Putt to the village, if we think about the future, that really could be more village-like, right? I mean, it's not now, it's kind of a mix of stuff, but that could be more village-like. That could be more walkable. That could be maybe the buildings eventually want to come more forward in that stretch. Maybe try to get the parking off, the, you know, instead of in the front, more towards the rear, and that type of thing. Everyone liked the idea of a buffer around the thruway. The stretch from Putt, again, now to Ohioville, again, the bike path, that stretch is the way we see the bike path issue as being most important. We might want to keep some space for that, keeping some trees by the thruway, maybe some adding more buffer to the thruway. For the most part, thinking of the frontage along 299 also as somewhat buffered, all the way out to pretty much the Paradise Lane. There were some thoughts about utilizing this area for maybe moving people to downtown, like a trolley or something, and getting, you know, helping keep some of the traffic out. We talked about some other traffic improvements that might be useful out there, like roundabouts and some of the and some of those intersections. And then we talked about the hamlet, Ohioville, recognizing that it really does have its own character, infrastructure is no limitation. You know, no one wants to see it explode into a village number two, but they see it as being a potential place for some more walkability, some small homes, some mixed use perhaps with some ground floor commercial and upper floor residential. Maybe this would be a good place to stop along the trail. And the thought was that, you know, really focus on this as a hub for the trail, either, you know, to park and ride into the village or to head the other way, to sit and eat. Maybe it's a draw for some commercial activity, maybe some trailhead of some type. Maybe this is an area as well for some affordable housing and multi-family housing. And believe it or not, even the notion of, you know, where the resort property has been proposed, you know, even thinking about some housing there, being close to the hamlet and mixed, you know, in a hamlet type of a style. So I thought that was kind of an interesting opportunity. But it was, you know, the notion of affordable housing came from a recognition that this is a real big issue in the town, throughout the town. There's a big service economy here in New Paltz, and you know, that might even be contributing to the traffic problem to some degree, because people can't afford to live here if they work here. So it's interesting, very well-informed conversation, a lot of ideas, and I thought it was very helpful. So thank you. Katie, I'm going to ask you to go next.
Right, so you stole a lot of what I was.
That's why I go first.
I know. So I'm just going to try and fill in the gaps. So I guess my favorite idea, not to be biased, is we talked a lot about a visitor center right when you come off the thruway. So, you know, a place where you can park, you can get some snacks, get some water from the trail. You know, really just a place where we can kind of, you know, tell people where to go, tell people what's cool around here, you know, go from there. What else? We talked a lot about bike and pedestrian safety, especially along the corridor. There's a huge need for intersections so that people can safely cross. We also talked a lot about specific design elements that we would like to see in the area. A lot of it was what we went through in the presentation. And then I'd say our biggest focus is on, you know, sustainability and being environmentally conscious in our new development.
Oh, you got somebody. Thank you.
Well,
come on up. Come on.
Right.
Yeah, basically. Awesome.
I'm Catherine. So we had a very nice, lively conversation. Many of the same things. We talked about the transportation safety and flow and how terrifying it is already, especially in that section from the thruway with cars getting off for gas and then zipping across and taking a left. And trying to imagine bicyclists and pedestrians going through that is pretty hard. We talked about absolutely requiring any developers to create a bicycle and pedestrian trail through their property, to have it set back from the road, not like the village, but to have that be the green and trees with the trail and the parking to the side and the back whenever possible. Some people that I heard were a little nervous about having more residential and housing put in there, particularly close to the village, because there was some talk about how density is always talked about, but perhaps we're already to our limits in terms of cars and such. We talked about limiting not just the height, but we felt even more strongly about limiting the square footage of any development going in so that we don't have these huge sprawling box stores. And we talked about much as you had in your presentation about some design standards. We were speaking about going and having developers be inspired by the historic district or by Mohawk House, some of those kind of what's that cool architectural term for it? It comes from this area. Thank you. Thank you. We talked about some kind of way to tie together the two sides of the neighborhood that was cut by the freeway. How to somehow get that more connected, to have the sense that that is still one neighborhood instead of two. We weren't quite sure how to do that, but to have that be a focus. also saw kind of that hub around Ohioville Hamlet to have that feel more villagey, perhaps have some more intense development there. Let's see. We had a whole bunch of fun stuff. Some of us wanted to see nothing, only trees. Other people wanted to see some of the businesses, but I think everybody wanted a lot of green and a lot of trees.
Is that the same everywhere in the park, or is it different in some places?
I think
crossing across the freeway should be absolutely independent of the roadway. cantilevered off. There was a couple of us who suggested the idea of having a separate bicycle bridge across the thruway. And actually taking advantage of this area, I've got to orient myself, but taking advantage of this area as we come off the thruway, where there's a large wetland pond, and perhaps this area could be either there or on the other side of the thruway, a visitor center connected to the bike lane that would bring people there. But the recognition is that there's a lot of cars involved, so where we need some kind of centralized parking.
Yes.
One thought was whether we could engage DOT to actually use the parking lot to perhaps maybe build a two-story parking lot that would just surface park. We sort of identified this area as we come off the thruway and going west is an area that we might like to have a different kind of development than what we might want to have in this section to the east. There seemed to be consensus that this was more of the gateway to the village, and that precisely where you put the parking would perhaps impact how that would look, but we'd like to have something that would encourage people as you come off the thruway to sort of, how do we identify what is the what's that feel, the vernacular, the kinds of things that we offer there. And then in this area, we didn't have as much discussion about what kinds of development would be here, but it was pointed out again by somebody who lives in this area that there are a lot of homes, there are a number of homes in this area. And so perhaps, you know, some additional residential development of some sort, maybe with a commercial strip along the Route 299 might be something that would sort of build off of the Hamel idea. I suggested the idea of, could we look at 299 in this section as actually a boulevard? Could we actually put a tree line lead to create something that would have a very different kind of
thing?
There was, as somebody else already mentioned, a strong desire to have some kind of free shuttle service from whatever this parking ride is that would get people into the village, if they, either with their bicycles or if you didn't have a bicycle. We did talk about a local vernacular, idea of using stone and timber. Somebody mentioned the recently renovated Worcester Hall on the swimming campus as an example of the building that is very modern, but also speaks to the region in many of its architectural details, both exterior and interior. Again, just for emphasis, crosswalks are essential. We talked about the gateway development, relationship with pedestrians and bikes. Oh, and the last thing was that in any sorts of design guidelines, as other groups said, we would strongly like to have emphasis on sustainable development, so requiring some degree of LEED certification in your buildings, or LEED type certification, maybe not 100%, but 25% or 30%, and requirements to be able to generate a certain amount of your own power, that's protected. So,
thank you. Please do make sure that Ted gets those, or, yeah.
Just one thing that wasn't mentioned is we were talking about putting the power lines and the utility lines over there.
Everybody wants the power lines underground. That's, I understand. Or, you know, you can also do things like backlot the power lines sometimes. There's different ways that you can do it. So anyway, great. Thank you very, very much. We, you know, obviously after tonight are going to go back, make sure we, each of us who were in the groups, spend a little time fleshing out the notes so that we, so they still mean something to us, you know, a week from now. But just so you know, the committee will be meeting again at the end of the month on June 27th, actually right here at 7 o'clock. Those meetings are working meetings of the committee, so they're not like this where, you know, it's all about trying to get feedback, but you're welcome to come. You're welcome to listen to the committee do its business. There is a spot on the agenda for public comment, so there is a place for that if you're so inclined. But you're welcome to join us. We've been trying to meet on the fourth Thursdays, although we're not meeting in July, so it's, just look at the website. Yep, 27th at 7. And one of the things that I think will be, you know, the main focus of that meeting is going to be trying to, like, distill a little bit about what we heard tonight and how that sort of informs where we might go with our, you know, recommendations going forward. The website is active. You can actually send me an email through it if you want. So please take advantage of that. If you think of something else after tonight, or someone you know couldn't be here and has some opinion, please encourage them to take advantage of it. And that's it. It is 9 o'clock, but I'm gonna give you 2 minutes, 3 minutes here for a couple quick thoughts or questions.
Yeah. I have a question.
Yes.
So there was a question about the role of the committee.
Yes.
So, is your goal to make recommendations to the town board that could include things like zoning changes and design guidelines?
Right. Yeah, and I'm sorry if I didn't make that clear enough, but yes, the committee is advisory, in this, all right, so they will be making recommendations both for maybe like some comprehensive plan update as it relates to this corridor, and then zoning recommendations. But ultimately, it will be the town board that, of course, would have to adopt those things or change them in some way. Yes. The slides. Oh, yeah, I can put the slides on the website. Yes, I hadn't thought of that. Yes.
How do we know what's doable in terms of zoning, in terms of the sort of framework that you guys are working with, and what you can actually do, and what changes you can actually do for the zoning?
Mm-hmm.
Is there any way to sort of clarify that so that it gives sort of the public an idea of, like, you know, hey, why can't we build a skyscraper? Right? You know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
like, you know, like something to clarify what's actually doable in this area,
right?
So it can give everybody, again, give everybody a framework of what we didn't think about.
I think if you come to the next public meeting, which again will probably be in September, all right, we obviously don't have a date yet, but I know we'll have a little bit more concrete, obviously, something to react to, I think, at that point. You know, what's possible, what's doable is, a lot of that is, you know, I think it's based on our experience working with communities like yours throughout the state, right? So it's not, this isn't the first time we've been through something like this. So it, you know, I think we'll hopefully temper, you know, everyone's got, there's a lot of big ideas, a lot of big aspirations. We get that, and that's good. And that's what we need at this kind of meeting. But, you know, some of that will have to be tempered to what's doable. Like, thankfully, you know, no one in any of the groups that I heard at least said, you know, can we zone out all chains? You know, chain this or that. Well, I guess, you know, the answer to that question would be, you know, you're on a very thin legal footing when, to do that. Right? It's not to say that you couldn't possibly do some of that, but you'd have to, there'd be a lot of, you'd have to do a line of a proper basis for doing something like that, you know? So, you know, we have a pretty good sense of where those lines are, and we'll be bringing that to the recommendations. All right, guys, thank you very much. Really great, appreciate it.
If anybody is a registered Democrat here in the town of New Paltz, please come out and vote. We have not signed anyone's petition for the town.